And our word for today on this Friday of the 20th week in Ordinary Time, this Friday, August the 25th, our word for today is commandment. Commandment, our word for today. Our reading from the book of Ruth, chapter 1. Once in the time of the judges, there was a famine in the land, so a man from Bethlehem of Judah departed with his wife and two sons to reside on the plateau of Moab. Elimelech, the husband of Naomi, died, and she was left with her two sons, who married Moabite women, one named Orpah, the other Ruth. When they had lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion died also, and the woman was left with neither her two sons nor her husband. She then made ready to go back from the plateau of Moab, because word reached her there that the Lord had visited his people and given them food. Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth stayed with her. Naomi said, "See now, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and her God. Go back after your sister-in-law." But Ruth said, "Do not ask me to abandon or forsake you. Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, and your God my God." Thus it was that Naomi returned with the Moabite daughter-in-law Ruth, who accompanied her back from the plateau of Moab. They arrived in Bethlehem at the beginning of the barley harvest. Our responsorial psalm, Psalm 146. Praise the Lord, my soul. Blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord his God, who made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them. The Lord keeps faith forever, secures justice for the oppressed, gives food for the hungry. The Lord sets captives free. The Lord gives sight to the blind. The Lord raises up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the just. The Lord protects strangers. The fatherless and the widow he sustains, but the way of the wicked he thwarts. The Lord shall reign forever, your God, O Zion, through all generations. Alleluia.
Alleluia, alleluia. Teach me your paths, my God. Guide me in your truth. Alleluia, alleluia. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. When the Pharisees heard that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a scholar of the law, tested him by asking, "Teacher, which commandment of the law in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The whole law and the prophets depend on these two commandments."
And our word for today is commandment. Our Holy Father's thoughts regarding today's gospel reading, these he shared at his Angelus address on October the 25th of 2020. This is one of the primary innovations of Jesus' teachings, and it helps us understand that what is not expressed in love of neighbor is not true love of God, and likewise, what is not drawn from one's relationship with God is not true love of neighbor. Love for God is expressed above all in prayer, particularly in adoration. We neglect the adoration of God a great deal. We recite the prayer of thanksgiving, the supplication to ask for something, but we neglect adoration. Adoring God is precisely the heart of prayer, and love for neighbor, which is also called fraternal charity, consists in closeness, listening, sharing, caring for others. And so we often neglect to listen to others because it's boring, or because it takes up our time, or we neglect to accompany them, to support them in their suffering, in their trials. The Apostle John writes, "He who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen." Thus we see the unity of these two commandments. Again, the Apostle John writes, "He who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen." Thus we see the unity of these two commandments, love for God and love for neighbor. Commandment, our word for today. You know, I think if you want to measure the authentic love, if we want to measure the authentic love that we each individually have for God, we have to admit to this one thing based on these two commandments, and that is that we love God as much as we love the individual that we can't stand the most. Who is that individual that causes us such irritation, maybe even pain? Who are those individuals who are associated with a different way of thinking than us? Those that we have decided in our own lives are enemies of ours, which, by the way, we are not permitted to have as Christians. We have one enemy, that is the devil himself. Everyone else is either a follower of Christ who has found Christ and is living for Christ, or they are victims of the evil one. Simple as that. You're either a victim of the evil one or you're a follower of Christ. It doesn't get, it's no more complicated than that. You know, and the way that we treat victims in every other area of life is we minister to them. We minister to them in their need. We don't come up against them. Who ever found a person lying in the street because they've been hit by a car, a pedestrian hit by a car, and goes out and starts screaming at them? You know, no, you minister to them in their need. And so that's how we treat victims. But we have allowed ourselves as a society to divide up between enemies and friends. Well, that's not permitted in the Christian walk, and it certainly is not permitted when we look at these two commandments, to love the Lord our God with all our heart, mind, and soul, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourselves. These are the two greatest commandments. And we have to live by those commandments. They're not suggestions. They're absolute commandments. And so we have to come to the point where we can rise above what we see with our eyes, what we experience with our feelings, when all of these arguments and in some very, very important issues are raised, and there's a voice out there or voices out there that are contradictory to everything that we believe. And in fact, they're not just contradictory, they're militant against everything we believe. But we have to be careful not to then make enemies of these people, because we can't love God more than we love one individual in this world. We just can't. You can't. How can you say that you love the God that you can't see when you don't love the brother that you can see, John says? I mean, again, it's so simple that maybe it's easy to dismiss, but we ought not dismiss it. We really should ask ourselves, who is that person that I have the most difficulty loving? Father, I acknowledge with that person that individual is made in your image and likeness, that you love that person, that you love them so much that you lay down your life for them, that you love them so much that you want them with you forever in eternity, that you do not rejoice at the death of the sinner, but that you rejoice when someone comes home to you, that I might have that same desire for them, and that I might let go of hatreds, that I might burn up my enemies list and understand that we have only one enemy, your enemy, the enemy of your people. And otherwise, we do not carry about in our hearts and minds this list of people who are enemies of ours, that we might let that go, and today that we might be faithful to follow your commandment, your two great commandments, to love you with all of our hearts, minds, soul, and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves, understanding how much you love them. Again, the Apostle John writes, "He who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen." Thus we see the unity of these two commandments. Commandment, our word for today.